If you have your Bibles, turn to John 6, verses 37 through 48. And here Jesus is speaking, and he says, "All that the Father gives me will come to me, and the one who comes to me, I will certainly not cast out. For I have come down from heaven, not to do my own will, but the will of him who sent me. And this is the will of him who sent me." That of all that he was given to me, I lose nothing, but raise it up on the last day. For this is the will of my Father, that everyone who beholds the Son and believes in him will have eternal life. And I myself will raise him up on the last day. Therefore the Jews were grumbling about him, because he said, "I am the bread of heaven that came down out of heaven." They were saying, "Is not this Jesus, the son of Joseph, whose father and mother we know? How does he now say, 'I have come down out of heaven'?" Jesus answered and said to them, "Do not grumble among yourselves. No one can come to me unless the Father who sent me draws him, and I will raise him up on the last day. It is written in the prophets, 'And they shall all be taught of God.' Everyone who has heard and learned from the Father comes to me. Not that anyone has seen the Father except the one who is from God. He has seen the Father. Truly, truly, I say to you, he who believes has eternal life. I am the bread of life."
Let's pray. God, our salvation is a blessing, a magnificent blessing that we should behold and see the beauty of as we launch into 2017. Father, with an accurate view of our salvation, being in awe and overwhelmed at its beauty and your grace, we can then start to take upon ourselves resolutions, ideas, concepts, goals for this next year. Because God, without an understanding and appreciation of who we are in you through Christ, what meaning shall those things have if it doesn't bring you glory? So God, put us in such awe of what you will accomplish for us through the bread of life, your Son, Jesus Christ, that we only want to serve you through it with such an appreciation that the fire that you put in us through our salvation would grow stronger, never dim, and not burn out. Holy Spirit, do this work as we desire to understand both your predestination of us and our choosing of you. Amen. As we are in John chapter 6 this morning, we are looking at part 1 of this message I'm entitling, "The Beauty of Our Salvation." Part 1 is going to be looking at the mystery of you and I being drawn to God. Today, we step into the deep waters of God's grace and our salvation. Today, we bore deeper into the core of our faith than many are ever willing to go. So I think it's a perfect message for those who planned ahead last night on New Year's Eve to be here on New Year's Day. This is a gift for you, those faithful few that said, "You know what? I'm going to make this first day of the new year, though it be a Sunday, though it be early, though last night we probably all stayed up late, I'm going to make this year a priority by starting off with God." And for you, you'll have this gift of diving deeper into the understanding of your salvation than you may have ever gone, and maybe further than anybody's ever taken you. Today, we look at the matters of your salvation concerning two things that most people don't consider working together. Today, we'll look at statements from Jesus that both concern God's foreknowledge and his predestination for us in salvation, yet at the same time, we'll see themes throughout the scripture from the very same mouth that talked about predestination of Jesus, that talks about man's free will to choose. And these two things will work in coordination, not contradiction with one another. But as we launch into this series of John again, we step off into the deep end. This is the deep end of the pool, but don't be afraid of the deep end of the pool just because you don't understand what's over there. Because this, where we dive in today, the deep waters of God's truth, this theological truth, and the theological ocean of John, this is where you and I will learn to swim. God wants us to grow in our ability to swim, as I'm using that as an illustration of your faith. God wants you to grow in your faith. He doesn't want you to stay in the shallow end your whole life. He doesn't want you to stay a babe in Christ your whole life. He wants you to learn, to expand your mind, to stretch it, to challenge yourself, and to grow. That's why he gave you a mind. Not just to learn things like mathematics and physics, those are great things, but to give you a mind that was capable of learning those things, these complicated things of the world, that same mind also to learn the great and the deep things of him. Let us use it for that this morning. After all, Paul says in 1 Corinthians 14:20, brethren, do not be children in your thinking. Paul says if you want to be an infant in something, be an infant in evil. Be a novice in doing evil. But in your thinking, Paul says, be mature, like every child. We must all grow up into adults and learn how to swim in the deep end on our own. But for many Christians, we've been content splashing around in the shallow end of our faith for our whole life. Why? Because the deep end scares us. Matters of deep theology scare us away from the deep end. So what would we do? We remain dog paddling with the toddlers long into our adult life, and many of us even into death. I used to teach swimming lessons, and so I understand that it's a process. I remember taking, usually it's a little child. It's much harder when they're adults, which many of you are today, but that's okay. It's much easier to teach a child to swim, because what you do, it's a process. You start them in the water when they're real little. And the smaller they are, the less scared they're going to be. But because many moms and dads don't even pour the water on their child's head in fear of the water touching their nose and eyes, they come to me when I was teaching swimming lessons for like 7 years, and the first thing we do is just splash water on our face, right? Just to get our face wet. And then we'd start blowing bubbles. You know, once you start blowing bubbles and the water's just covering your face, then we could put the child's head underwater. And once they became okay with their head underwater, then we'd start gliding in the pool. I would hold them, I would support them with their face in the water. We'd just start gliding together. And then eventually I would let them glide by themselves, and I'd catch them. Let them glide by themselves. And to that glide, I'd eventually add a kick. Next thing you know, they're a little kicking around the pool like little torpedoes, and then I'd add the arms in, and guess what they're now doing? Swimming. But many of them weren't satisfied, like many of you in your faith are not satisfied just swimming in the shallow end. They'd go over there and they'd look at the deep things. They'd look at the diving board like Christian does and be like, I want to go off that. It scares me to death, but I want to go off that. That's how I want you to approach the deep theological understanding of both God's sovereignty and man's free will. Be excited about approaching subjects of such depth. But the children who wanted to go to the deep end, I'd be like, no, no, you can't go to the diving board unless you pass the swim test. Well, where's the swim test? In the deep end. And they're like, oh. So I'd take them to the deep end for a few sessions, and they'd swim over there. And once they navigated the deep waters, they'd jump off the diving board, and they would be fine. Today, as we approach these two subjects of God's sovereignty and man's free will, no, you may not have a complete understanding today, and yes, men much smarter than I have approached these subjects and not come away with the complete understanding. But that does not mean you should not approach subjects like this, because the deep end is where God grows your faith. What I pray today that you see above everything else, as we are diving into the deep end of John chapter 6 together, is that you would see the beauty of your salvation. You would see both the beauty of God drawing you, and you also see the beauty of you choosing him. We would also look at the beauty of how God does it. All of this, not just from my mouth explaining theological things, all of this is going to come from the very mouth of Jesus Christ. A quote that I read about God's foreknowledge, his predestination, and how it works with our own free will. Probably the best quote I've ever read on this subject comes from a man named Charles Haddon Spurgeon. You've probably heard of him. He was a preacher in London, and he delivered a sermon on August 1st, 1858, and he said this. I think it'll help you. He said, I see in one place God presiding over all in his providence, and yet I see, and can't help but seeing, that man acts as he pleases, and that God has left man's actions to his own will in a great measure. Now, If I were to declare that man was so free to act that there was no precedence of God over his actions, he said, I would be driven to atheism. And if, on the other hand, I declare that God so overrules all things and that man is not free enough to even be responsible, I'm driven at once to antinomianism or fatalism, which means simply that there is no moral law and that nothing matters because it's all out of your hands anyway. He goes on to say that God predestines and that man is responsible are two things that few can see. These two things are believed to be inconsistent and contradictory, but they are not. It is just the fault of our weak minds, he says, our weak judgment. Two truths, if they are truths, cannot be contradictory to each other. He says, if then I find taught in one place in the scriptures that everything is foreordained, guess what? That is true. And if I find in another place that man is responsible for his actions, that also is true. And it is my folly that leads me to imagine that these two truths can ever contradict each other. These two truths, I do not believe, can ever be welded into one upon any human anvil. But they shall be one in eternity. They are two lines that are so nearly parallel that the mind that shall pursue them the furthest will never discover that they ever converge. But they do converge. And they will meet somewhere in eternity, close to the throne of God, whence all truth has come. That's exactly how I see it. God's predestination and foreknowledge of you, running parallel, in fact, working with the truth of man's free will. They do come together, and we're going to see it in this passage of Scripture, but many times they come together at the point past where the human finite mind can go. But let us try to approach these things together in John chapter 6. We have to find our bearings in John chapter 6 first. We've kind of come back to the series. Remember, John chapter 6, the very beginning, what did Jesus do? He fed the multitudes, and he did this with just a little bit of bread and just some fish, and he multiplied it, and he fed the multitudes. Everybody was blown away. Everybody was in shock and awe. They were all ready to listen to Jesus. Now, Jesus uses the rest of those who are listening, the time that he has with them, and some would argue even the rest of the gospel, using this miracle of feeding the multitudes as an illustration of what he came to do. See, Jesus came to provide our salvation. Jesus came to feed our souls. After all, he says, look here in verse 35, right before we get to verse 37, which is where we're starting today. He says, okay, you've seen everybody eat the bread and they've been nourished and satisfied? That's me. You remember that I am statement, the first of the eight, if you include before Abraham was I am in your I am calculations? He says, I am the bread of life. He who trust in me or comes to me will never hunger. He who believes in me will never thirst. And then in verse 37, Jesus now bores deeper. He dives deeper into the meaning of what it is to have him as your bread of life. He will go on talking about treating him as the bread of life. As if he is the bread of life, what do you do with bread? You eat it, you consume it, you're nourished by it. And that's why in John chapter 6, verses 50 through 59, Jesus says, you shall eat my flesh and drink my blood. We'll get there next week. What Jesus is doing in these verses is an offering invitation for all of us to see him as the bread of life, the provider of salvation and the sustainment for everything that we would ever need. But look at verse 36. He says, all of you, like you're looking at me now, you see me. Many of you see me, but many of you don't truly believe in me. Even in this very discourse, as Jesus is finishing this teaching in the synagogues, many people, right after he gets done saying these words, in verse 70, they start leaving and they depart from him. Verse 37, all that the Father gives me will come to me, and the one who comes to me, I will surely not cast out. You see what's happening in that one verse as Jesus dives a little bit deeper into what it means for him to be the bread of life? Jesus, in this one verse, brings both of these thoughts, this God's preordination, his predestination, and man's free will, he brings them together in one verse. Look at the first part of that verse. All that the Father gives me will come to me. That means it's predestined. It's a very predestined type of verse. What God knows will happen. What Jesus is doing here is he says the second part of this verse, look what he says, and the one who comes. He doesn't mention the Father doing anything here. Now the responsibility is on you. The one who comes, in other words, the one who chooses to come to me, I will not cast out. Jesus uses the statement like a bow to put on top of the gift of salvation that we all enjoy. And just like any bow on any gift, it's meant to make the gift look more beautiful, not to distract from the beauty of the gift. He puts the bow on the present to accentuate the beauty of our salvation, not to let issues like God's predestination and his free will working together to distract from the beauty of our salvation. Those who let these issues divide and cause division, they mar the beauty of what Christ has done for us. No, the beauty of predestination working with man's free will is supposed to be beautiful to you, to put you in such awe of what you have and what's been accomplished for you that you see the gift as even more beautiful, not as confusing and divisive. I hate that the devil has allowed us to use such beautiful and amazing things to divide so many, not only in other denominations, but in our very own denomination. All the Father gives me will come to me. That's him. The one, that means you, who chooses to come, Jesus says, I will not cast out. This is Jesus affirming that he will accept all those who come. He will not cast them out. He will not turn them away. You know what this shows me? Anyone can come. Everyone can come. Salvation is not limited by color, race, tribe, tongue, or nation. Salvation is not reserved for the religious elite. Salvation is not reserved for the Jews. Salvation is not reserved for those at Tabernacle. Salvation is not reserved for those in America. Salvation through Jesus Christ is global. It's for everyone here. It's for you today. It's for everyone out there. It's for them today and in us. In Texas, in America, and around the world, any man who comes to the Lord will be accepted. Or how the Bible says it, all those who call in the name of the Lord will be what? Will be saved. I want you to own that personally, because that means you and you and you and you all over here today as individuals. What we spend so much time is worrying about how God functions his role. Don't worry about God's role. You do your role, and you're sitting here today and you're hearing his word. He wants you to accept it. He wants you to consume the bread of life. He wants you to be saved. This message is for you. You are to respond. Don't push it away by putting on other theological things that you may not be able to grasp. See, it's not the job of you, and it's not the job of Jesus to choose. The job of Jesus was to die. And his sacrifice on the cross, it was sufficient for all of you. But it will only be effective if you come. Look at how he explains this further in verse 38 and 39 and 40. He says, for I have come down from heaven not to do my own will, but the will of him who sent me. Jesus is accomplishing the will of the Father that he is making known to him. And then Jesus says the same thing in two different ways in verse 39 and verse 40. You see, why would Jesus say the same thing in two different ways? Because the first verse, verse 39, the way he says God's will, is a very predestined type of verse. Look at it. He says, this is the will of him who sent me, that all he has given me. See who's doing the work there? God. I will lose none, and I will raise them up on the last day. You're like, okay, it's all God. No, no, wait, look at verse 40. For this is the will of my Father, says it again in a different way, that everyone who beholds, he doesn't mention God again, he mentions you. For everyone who chooses to behold the Son and believes in him has eternal life, and I myself will raise him up on the last day. Both are working together. God pre-knowing it, predestining it, and you choosing it. What we see in these three verses are the three responsible parties that must exist in coordination together to accomplish man's salvation. First, you see God, the most important part. What does God do? God chooses men, draws men to himself, actually to Christ through his Spirit, and then he sends them to Jesus. What does Jesus do? Jesus accepts all those who come. He pays the price for their salvation. He earns their eternal life. He sustains them, and he says, I will raise them up on the last day. But those are the first two. There's also a component to man's salvation that we cannot miss here. It's you. It's man. What is man's responsibility? To accept. To respond by coming to Christ. By believing and receiving and sharing the salvation with others. What a beautiful thing our salvation is. Each person must do their part. We need not spend too much time worrying about God's part. I spend a lot of time worrying about it. I don't know why. Many of you spend a lot of time worrying about it. It's good to ponder, to see his greatness and to be overwhelmed by his glory. But don't worry about God's part. He's God. God is God and you are not. That's a great lesson to learn. Just kind of hold on to that for the new year if you take nothing else today. But God is God and you are not. Let him worry about accomplishing salvation in another. What you need to spend more time worrying about, what is your part? Your part is to receive. Your part is to believe. Your part is to accept. And your part is to share. We must go and share this message with the city of Ennis. This is your Jerusalem. This is your home base. You need to be out there sharing with every man, woman, boy, and girl, every child in your home, every neighbor in your community, and every soul in this city, this county, and then as we stretch out further to the ends of the earth. It is God's job to accomplish your sharing and make it fruitful unto salvation. You don't need to spend a lot of time pondering, is this person drawn to God? Is this person the elect? No, you share the message of Christ coming and dying for man's sin, and guess what? He finds the elect. You don't worry about it. Oh, I learned this lesson so well when I was in Oxford, England on a Baptist study trip. You want to talk about some esoteric ideas. You want to talk about some heady knowledge. Well, I got it when I was there. It took 9 hours about theology and Baptist history while we were in Oxford, England. And boy, it was a challenge. And after about a week of this intense theological study, I said, we've got to go apply some of this. So some friends had the idea, well, let's go out into this university, which is the city, and the city is the University of Oxford. It's all together. It's all one. Let's go out and share this gospel message that we've been learning about. So we did. One night on the way out, or is afternoon, on the way out to go share, some of the friends were staying back and they were wanting to ponder this Reformed theology. Nothing wrong with that. I was just learning about the Reformation. I wasn't quite grasping what Reformed theology meant. I was just starting to learn the ideas of predestination and God's foreknowledge and man's free will and how it's all working together. I was just barely touching these issues. But on my way out one afternoon, a young man came to me and he goes, are you Reformed? I was thinking, okay. It's a theological question. I've been learning this. Okay. The Reformation, right? John Calvin, Erwin Zwingli, which by the way, January 1st is his birthday. Yeah, that's a good one. And then Martin Luther. I go, okay, yes. Yes, we all believe in the Reformation. That's why we're Baptist. I go, yes, I'm Baptist like you, and so I believe in the Reformation. I go, aren't you Reformed? I thought he was asking me if I believe in the Reformation. And then he goes into this theological discussion about whether I should be going out and ministering the gospel to those who are lost if God already knew that they would be elect anyway. I was shocked. I was offended, to be honest, a little bit. I'd already seen the benefits from obeying God in the Great Commission. And I said something that day that I still believe is true today. I said, it is not our job to know or not to know who accepts Christ. Our job is to share. His job is to draw and accomplish their salvation. Then I said this, I know that every time I am consistently obedient to sharing the message that God has called me to share, I find the elect. Our job is to be consistent. Our job is to be obedient to the Great Commission. You go out and share, and what you're going to run into is people surrendering to Christ as their Savior who are then the elect when they make that decision. Look at what the Jews struggled with. I think it's interesting. As we approach verse 42, We spend so much time worrying about God's predestined will and his foreknowledge and man's free will. The Jews, they didn't struggle with any of that. Look at the question that they come back to Jesus with. They're not worried about God knowing. They're not worried about man choosing. Theirs is much more personal. Look what they say in verse 42. Is this not Jesus, the son of Joseph, whose father and mother we know? How does he now say, I have come down out of heaven? They're not even worried necessarily that he calls himself the bread of life. They're like, listen, I know you. Your dad's Joseph. He's a carpenter. Your mom is Mary. You're from Galilee, not heaven. They let their human intellect keep them from understanding Christ as their Savior. They were blind to the divine nature of Jesus because of their worldly misunderstanding. They were unable to see, and either they didn't know or forgot that Jesus was born of a virgin, that his father was not Joseph, his heavenly father made him to be pure, and that he was the Savior of the world. They were blinded by their human understanding. Their human rationale kept their faith from traveling far enough from their mind to their heart to be saved. Here's what I want to tell you today as we discuss such deep issues, and we're going to go even deeper. Deep issues of God's predestination and God's free will. Don't let your human misunderstanding of predestination and man's free will keep you from believing upon Jesus Christ and trusting him as your Savior and with every single part of your life. Listen to how Jesus responds to their confusion. It's a great example. They're confused about how he thinks he can come from heaven, and then he says to them in verse 43 of John chapter 6, he doesn't address their confusion, he doesn't address the issue. He says, stop grumbling amongst yourselves. He didn't address the foundation of the grumbling, he says, stop grumbling. And then what he does to answer their question, he dives deeper into his explanation of how God draws them into salvation through him, the bread of life. So that's what we're going to do. You say, wait a second, Pastor. I'm just starting to reel a little bit from this idea of predestination and man's free will. How can we go deeper? Why would we go deeper? I'll tell you why we go deeper. Number one, because Christ goes deeper. He's not talking to a bunch of theologians. He's talking to men and women like you and me. He wants us to go deeper into these things. Why? Because the deeper we go and the further we stretch our mind, the more beautiful it will become, and the more beautiful your salvation becomes to you, it will be fuel for you to accomplish his will in 2017. All of your New Year's resolutions that you're starting to make about dieting and Bible reading or whatever it may be are useless if they don't have the glory of God in Christ and your salvation in him at the very center of them. That's why we're diving so deep today. Secondly, I'm not only going deeper because Jesus goes deeper, I'm going deeper because I want to know. Don't you want to know how God accomplished this thing in you in Christ, the bread of life? Don't you want to know how this happens spiritually? Maybe you were saved at 6 and you can't really remember the exact day. Don't you want to know the mind of God as it was happening so you can be in awe of it? Maybe you were a teenager and you do remember the day. Or maybe you were 30, 40, 50, 60, or 70 years old when you came into Christ in salvation. Or maybe you don't remember because you're not saved. One of my prayers for you today is that those who are here that do not yet believe, even as we're discussing the deep things of believing, God would use his word and teach your heart, and even by hearing them, you would believe today. So the first thing in this process, what does Jesus say? Look at verse 44. The first thing that he says is nobody can come to him unless God draws him. No one can come to me unless the Father who sent me draws him. This word draw here means to attract, to woo, or even to spiritually drag. And the drawing of the Father to Jesus Christ, the bread of life, is effectual, triumphant even. Why would you resist the draw of God who is bringing you to Christ in order to save you from your sin and eternal punishment? I call this a no-brainer response. Of course you want to respond to that. I'll tell you this, though. However you respond, no man has ever come to God through Christ that wasn't first drawn by God. That's what he's saying here. No one comes to me unless they're first drawn by God. This is not a forceful draw like a man upon an unwanting woman. This is a gentleman pleading with you to come to him because he knows the best for you. It's not a guilt call, it's a sweet call. It's not a forceful drawing. It's a gentle drawing to come into the best and most wonderful relationship you could ever imagine. So what is he drawing you to? Several things. Number one, God is drawing you to repentance, to turn away from your life that you've been living for yourself and to now live your life and everything in it for him. It's a draw to believe in Christ, not just mental knowledge, but willful change. It's a draw to Christ and his atoning death for forgiveness. It's also a draw to die with Christ as you sacrifice everything for his sake. But not only is it a draw to die, look what he says here in verse 47. It's also a draw to live and to never die again. Truly, truly, I say to you, he who believes has eternal life. There's lots of things that he's drawing you to, but if you would yet respond to his drawing, there's lots of benefits you get from responding to that drawing. Benefit number one, eternal life. Yes, your body may fade and that broken down old vehicle that you've been driving, that flesh sack of sin you've been moving around this earth, yes, it may go away, but once you respond to his draw, you will never die again. Your soul will live on forever. But not only that, it gets better. One day your soul will be reunited with your broken body and they'll both be restored in one in the great day of the resurrection. That's benefit number two, the resurrected body that you will have like Christ had when you get it from him as he calls you unto it. Benefit number three to responding to God's call, sustainment. The bread of life that Jesus is, we are meant to consume, and that bread of life is Christ who saves us, but also Christ who will sustain us for all of eternity. When Jesus says in John 6:37, I will not turn anyone away who comes to me. The transverse way of looking at that is that I will grab you when you come to me, and I will hold on to you, and I will never let you go again. That's why Paul says in Romans 8:35, who will separate us from the love of Christ? Will tribulation? Some of you are experiencing that today. Will that separate you from the love of Christ? What about stress? What about persecution or starvation or nakedness or peril or even death by a gun or death by a sword? It's a rhetorical question. None of these things will separate you from the love of Christ once you respond to him through the drawing of God. He finishes the statement up in Romans 8:38 and 8:39. For I am convinced, Paul says, because he was drawn, that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor any created thing will be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. Respond to the drawing of God and receive eternal life in Jesus Christ, the bread of life. He will sustain you for today, and he will sustain you for all of eternity. He will never let you go. Ladies and gentlemen, that's called good news. But let's go even deeper. Practically, what does it look like, and how does it work spiritually on the inside for God to draw you to Christ, the bread of life, to be saved? Jesus says, I want you to know. Look at verse 45. It is written in the prophets, they shall be taught of God. Everyone who has heard and learned from the Father comes to me. How does God draw you to Christ, the bread of life? By teaching your heart. Look at the verbs and the participles here in verse 45. Taught, heard, learned. They shall be taught of God. This is something you cannot do. Everyone who has heard, who heard who? God. Has learned from who? God. They come to me. God's drawing is effective because God is your instructor and he teaches your heart. That means there's no Charlie Brown teaching in your salvation when God is teaching you. None of that. Wah, 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 wah. You know, you never understood what Charlie Brown's teacher was saying to him? Wah, wah. No, there's none of that with God. His teaching is always effective. Oh, I wish my teaching was that effective. So many that hear my words sit out there, and some of you fall asleep, and some of you don't listen, and some of you kind of turn it away, and some of you reject it, and some of you disdain it. Not with God, no. Every time God teaches in the concept of salvation, you learn every time. It never fails. It never comes back void. Jesus is quoting a passage from Isaiah. You know it's an Old Testament passage, especially if you have the NASB version of the Bible. This is one of the reasons I suggest it, because the quotation is all in block letters. When you see something in all caps, it means it's coming from the Old Testament. So what is that Old Testament verse? Isaiah 54, 13. An expression of the new covenant that we have by being taught by God. And it appears, the effects are in the New Testament, but it appears in the Old Testament prophet of Isaiah. In Isaiah 54, 13, he says, all your sons will be taught of the Lord, and the well-being of your sons will be great. This is Isaiah prophesying to the people who one day will live in the restored city of Jerusalem after the Babylonian exile. D.A. Carson said of this quotation that this passage is here applied typologically. In the New Testament, the messianic community and the dawning of the saving reign of God are the typological fulfillments of the restoration of Jerusalem after the Babylonian exile. What this is an expression of the new covenant that we have in Christ. To better see this new covenant and how it's taught in us and given to us and written on our hearts, it's best to look at the best expression of the new covenant in the Old Testament, which is in Jeremiah chapter 31. Jeremiah 31, verse 31, listen to what God says about the new covenant which is coming, which we now enjoy. Behold, days are coming, declares the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and with the house of Judah. Not like the old covenant which I made with their fathers in the day I took them by the hand and I brought them out of the land of Egypt. My covenant which they broke, although I was a husband to them, declares the Lord. They messed it up. But this is the covenant I will make with the house of Israel after those days, declares the Lord. Listen to this. This is how God teaches your heart in salvation. I will put my law within them, and I will write it on their heart. And I will be their God, and they shall be my people. This is what it means to be taught of the Lord. These objective truths that you read on the pages of God's Word, these objective truths that I'm spouting from my lips today, they're taken by God in your salvation when you hear them. This is something only He can do, by the way. And He puts it in your heart. He writes it on your heart so that you can understand. So that it's not just some mental, intellectual knowledge. Many of you here today are lofty thinkers. You enjoy intellectual banter. You like conceiving the esoteric ideas of the world. You love philosophy. Hear me today. Your mental intelligence on its own will never be enough to bring you to God. It's God and God alone that takes these objective truths that you're hearing today and that you're reading today, and He writes it on your heart. He puts it inside of you if you would not let your pride get in the way. Once this impacted my soul this week, I was crushed. Literally, I was wounded, but I was wonderfully humbled all at the same time. See, I realized that the goal for me was not to have it all figured out. No, the goal was for me to be humble enough to allow God to figure it out for me. To call me, to draw me, and to change me. See, the goal is not intelligence, although you should use your intelligence. The goal is not arrogance and having it all figured out. The goal is humility. What I learned from this passage of Scripture, there are things in this world that you cannot know with the corrupted will, and only God, that's what He's telling you, only God changes the will. That's why it says in John chapter 7, verse 16, my teaching is not my own, but Him who sent me. And in John 7, 17, if anyone is willing to do His will, he will know of the teaching, whether it is of God or whether I speak of myself. Some of you here today may be prevented from knowing God and the truth He reveals because of your pride of life and your arrogance. But if you realize that you can't do it on your own or know it on your own, you let God teach you, you will learn to walk humbly in a relationship with Jesus Christ. God draws you to Christ by teaching you and overcoming your blindness to Him. This is what happens to you in salvation, and we see an example of God doing this in the Scriptures. Quickly now, turn with me to Matthew 16. Or you can look it up later. In Matthew 16, do you remember that interaction that Jesus had with Peter? He looks right at Peter, who is often spouting off things from the top of his mind, right? And many times, Peter takes out the sword and cuts off the guard's ear. He reacts, and he reacts wrongly. But Jesus asked the same guy, burly, quick, hot-tempered Peter, "Peter, who do you say that I am?" Notice the response of Peter. Peter says, "You are the Christ, the Son of the living God." What does Jesus say to him? "You're right. But Peter, this is not something that you learned from flesh and blood. This is something you learned from the Father." There are things and knowledges, especially in your salvation, that only God can teach you. He will change your will from wanting to serve yourself to wanting to trust in Christ. This is how your salvation is accomplished. But lest you forget the role of Christ in this, look at verse 47 of John chapter 6. "Truly, truly, I say to you, he who believes has eternal life." Believes in what? Believes in who? He tells you, "I am the bread of life." After God teaches your heart, after God writes his law inside of you, after he changes you, then you can see Christ, and only then can you see Christ for who he really is and truly believe in him and receive him. Christ then, through the power of the cross and the resurrection, he accepts you. He paid the price for you. He seals you for all of eternity. This is how you were drawn to God. And once you were drawn to God in salvation, then you were to go and tell it to others and let God draw them as well. Your role is very simple. Accept, believe, surrender, and then share. God both predestines you and he puts the responsibility upon you to respond to him. What a beautiful thing we have in the salvation of Christ. Let this beauty of your salvation cause a shock and awe in your heart that ripples not only in your mind today, as God has stretched it, but the ripple effects go throughout 2017. And like a pond that has a pebble dropped in it, the ripples would continue to go to the very edges of your life. This is the kind of stuff, if you can grasp it and let it impact you, can truly change the trajectory of your future life.